issues like women's position vis-a-vis the labor market and unequal pay, for example, or women's vulnerability to gender-specific violence, for another example, that things like this cannot be understood without reference to this fundamental, sharp structural division between production and reproduction. Let me just say a bit more, though, about what we mean by capitalism. We see ourselves here as presupposing and developing what I've elsewhere called an expanded view of capitalism. Capitalism is not just an economic system and not just a way of organizing the economy or the sphere of production. Capitalism is much larger. It's an entire social order that organizes the relation between production and reproduction. It organizes the relation between the market and the state, or the economy and the political system. It organizes the relation between human society and non-human nature. It organizes the relationship between exploited wage labor and so-called doubly free labor, and expropriated, unfree, and dependent labor. And I really appreciated Osvaldo's point about slaves. A huge amount of capitalist labor is even today unfree, although not legally enslaved, but deeply dependent, and is coerced and is regulated not through legal wage contracts, but through all sorts of non-contractual coercion. That's still the case. Okay, so capitalism is bigger than an economy. And the part of the story that is of special interest to feminists is the story about production and reproduction. I mean, it should be of interest to everyone. For us, this is the fundamental deep structure of capitalist society, as deep and as structural as the relation between capital and labor at the point of production. And this, for us, is the sort of linchpin of gender asymmetry. Not in a reductive sense, but we think, and we try to do it in the various 11 theses that are elaborated in the book, we think that issues like women's position vis-a-vis the labor market and unequal pay, for example, or women's vulnerability to gender-specific violence, for another example, that things like this cannot be understood without reference to this fundamental, sharp structural division between production and reproduction. And I should add that that is specific to capitalism. No previous society sharply institutionalized these things as totally separate in the way that capitalism does. And the effect is to render women subordinate not only to capital, which helps itself to our unwaged labor, our care work, and often depletes it and causes us to live like crazy people. But we also become subordinated even to working class men. And this is an issue that has to be faced politically. It introduces some complications into the way we normally think about class struggle. I would say, like Bhaskar, who says he's for class struggle social democracy, I would say we are for class struggle feminism and class struggle politics in general. But we are interested in thinking just as we have an expanded view of capitalism, an expanded view of what counts as a capitalist crisis, an expanded view of what counts as a contradiction of capitalism, including the care depletion that we see happening right now, especially ramped up under COVID. All of those things, even what counts as socialist feminism, changes when you take this broader view. So we see ourselves as building on Marx and Engels, and especially on Engels' idea that it's inadequate to define socialism as a socialization or collective ownership of the means of production, that it also has to mean socialization or collectivization of housework and social reproduction. That's fundamental, but it also has to involve changing the whole relation to nature, changing the whole relation between politics and economics.